tied in with what we were talking about this morning in the rather pernicious society in which we live. Extreme lasciviousness is found throughout. Then you might expect that there would be all sorts of marriage, divorce, and remarriage. Certainly many of them not accordance with God's will. So the question I pose this afternoon is, does God accept all marriages? Does God accept all marriages? We certainly know that God loves everyone, Romans 5:8. And we need to study to find out the kind of love that God has for lost mankind. Fundamentally, it's agape. It means that God always seeks man's highest good. That highest good, in view of the fact that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, Romans 3:23, and the wages of sin is death, Romans 6:23, then the highest good, as God loves us, all mankind, is to get us saved from our sins. Because all things about this life is limited. It comes new with use, it grows old, and then it disappears. God, who knows all things, certainly sees all things from the eternal standpoint. Therefore, this life is perfect for what God made it to be, and that's a place to get ready for eternity. So God has loved us in accordance with saving our souls and what must be in order to save us from sin and living our lives here. Life on earth is an opportunity to go to heaven. And it's the only time we get to make those choices, heaven or hell. God sent His Son to live the sinless life, tempted in every point like as we are, yet without sin. And being sinless, then He could die on behalf of everyone, for everyone's good, called a vicarious death. God wants everyone to be saved. Peter wrote that, 2 Peter 3:9. However, and this is what the denominational world simply does not grasp, we must be saved up on God's terms. Not our own, but God's terms. The false concept that to be saved by grace doesn't require any action on our part is just that, a false concept. And yet many people today think heaven's going to be their home because they assent to the fact that God is the Bible's Word of God and that Jesus Christ of Nazareth, the Son of God. Because the doctrine they follow doesn't require anyone to obey anything in order to be saved. Or if you are saved from their erroneous concept, anything of us in order to remain faithful. Because they look at all works as meritorious works. They do not see that there are those works that simply are our actions to respond to God in obedience to His will, demonstrating our love of God thereby, and our faith in God and godly things thereby. If they would think for a minute, there's just no other way anyone can show his love of God or his faith in God and the gospel system other than obeying God's will. Thus, Christ is the author of eternal salvation unto all them that obey Him. He never says that He will save those who assent to the fact that Jesus Christ of Nazareth is the Son of God and the Savior of the world. James makes it clear that faith apart from works is dead, being alone. Well, those can't be meritorious works. They have to be works of obedience. So we must be obedient if we want God to save us. That's clear, as I've already quoted from Hebrews 5:8 and 9. Now, having said these few things, we should look to the Word as always on everything, the Word of God, in regard to marriage, as it is an area in which we must be obedient to Him. I don't think a great many people who think themselves fine servants of God, when they look at their marriages, think that in marriage I must be obedient to Him. But we must be obedient to Him in our worship. We must be obedient to Him in our individual lives. Women must be obedient to Him in the role God and His Word has assigned them. Same is true of the man. In marriage, there are roles God's word lays upon the husband that he must perform, and the same of the wife. When it comes to parents, God's word lays obligations upon mom and daddy as to what they must do to rear their children. So why should we think that God would not demand of us to be obedient to him when it comes to the formation of a marriage, seeing that it's God who formed marriage in the first place? So when we look at the Bible teaching on marriage, we actually find the law of marriage mentioned. You might not have thought of it as that, but that's exactly what it is, set out in Matthew 19, 5 through 6. Now let me say this about the definition of law. Law is simply a rule of action. Law is a rule of action. What does that mean? Well, it simply means that since God requires us certain actions in order to be saved from our sins, and as Christians in order to be faithful to God, then we have to go to the law of God that governs that particular action on our part. Thus, we go to the rule of action regarding marriage and divorce and remarriage, or the rule of action regarding becoming a Christian, or the rule of action in the New Testament regarding worshiping God in spirit and in truth. And so you find the totality of the New Testament called the perfect law of liberty, James 1 and verse 25. God's grace, his favor that no man deserves and cannot merit to save us from sin, is extended to us through that body of truth known as the perfect law of liberty. So the idea that if grace is reigning today, that there's no law, is just false doctrine. If you look at what is said by Paul in Romans chapter 5, notice that he points out that grace reigns, which means it rules, reigns through righteousness. Verse 21 of Romans 5, that is, sin hath reigned unto death, in order to death, that's the end result. Even so might grace, God's favor, reign or rule, notice the avenue, through righteousness. But all of God's commandments, David says, are righteousness. Psalm 172, or 119, 172. And it can't be the law of Moses that is the righteousness, for Colossians 2:14 says that that's been taken out of the way, nailed to the cross. It is the law that is the law of Christ, the perfect law of liberty, the New Testament of the Christ. Grace reigns through righteousness unto, which means in order to a given end. And what is that end? Eternal life by Jesus Christ our Lord. When you transgress God's law, you sin, 1 John 3:4. The end of that is eternal death. Well, the other way around. Grace, God's favor to save us, the gospel system, for the gospel is his power to save, Romans 1:16. It reigns. It rules over mankind who needs that salvation. That grace reigns through the righteousness of God. Well, since it's not the law of Moses, it has to be the law of Christ. That needs to be understood when it comes to anything we do. That's why you can read Colossians chapter 3 and verse 17, whatsoever you do in word or in deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father by him. Is not marriage one of those things we do indeed? Certainly it is. So we ought to be seeking God's law of marriage. For this cause shall a man leave father and mother and shall cleave to his wife, and they twain or two shall be one flesh. Wherefore they are no more twain or two, but one flesh. What therefore God hath joined together, let not man put asunder. Let me emphasize the let there. I don't think we understand the meaning of the word let. It's sort of give or take in our minds. But let in the scripture means, says this is the way to do it, and don't mess with it. Because you really can't change it, even if you try. For example, we're taught to be, once we believed in Christ, repented of our sins, and confessed our faith in Christ, the Son of God, To finish our obedience to the gospel, we must be immersed in water by the authority of Christ, into the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, to obtain the remission of forgiveness of sins, to have salvation from sins. Well, when you consider that for a moment, then there's the rule of action with subpoints in it, or component parts of it, that tells us how God's grace reigns through righteousness, so that when we obey Him in that word, then God in His mind says, your sins are forgiven. I'll remember them against you no more. The Lord adds us to the church. That's why we're said to be raised to walk in newness of life. So when you look at this given situation, there's a law of marriage. Well, nobody's married unless he complies with that law. There are a lot of marriages against the law. No, not man law. Man's law approves by anything. But you need to ask yourself the question, and so does everybody, am I in a marriage that's against the law, God's law, the perfect law of liberty? If you're in that kind of marriage, God doesn't join you together. In reality, you're not married. And that's a very important point. You may be married according to civil law, but you know, there are people that are sprinkled thinking that's baptism, and they can think that all they want to, but are they? Are they baptized? No, they're not. People can call things all sorts of things, but what they need to be seeking is the mind of God. Now, there's only one place you find that, and that's in the divine volume in the words of the New Testament. So if you're going to know the law of marriage, you go to God's book. If you're going to know whether you have complied in the matter of marriage with God's law on marriage, then you have to know it. So look at it again. God's law of marriage. From the beginning, Jesus said, God made them male and female. Well, now we're hearing and have for a long time that two men can marry. Two women can marry. I don't know where the transgenders go. I guess they just transgender in anything they want to. You don't find anything like that in the inviolate word of the living God. Now the government may rise up and want to shut everybody down and accuse us of hate crimes and all that kind of thing. Doesn't change the word of God. May change how we get along in life as to how much we're persecuted or not. But if you're faithful, you'll still teach the truth. And that is, if anybody's going to be married, they have to comply with God's law of marriage. So in the beginning, God made them male and female. Now, why does he bring that up right here? Because nobody but a man and a woman is going to be married but God. And there's no use pulling any punches about it. I don't care how many of your friends don't like it. And there may be a lot of them nowadays. Or they just don't want to hear it. Or let me live like I want to live. Well, you can live like you want to live, but it still doesn't mean it's in harmony with God's law. You still haven't complied with God's law. Well, that's being awful, unloving, hateful, and you're being mean to tell me that. You can think however you want, but I've just told you the truth that will face you on the day of judgment. And to me, that seems rather loving. Neither Adam nor Eve had been in a marriage before God joined them together. Now you say, well, who else were they married? That's not the point. This is the first marriage. And they couldn't do just as they pleased. God joined them in marriage. Jesus says that when a man and a woman leave their father and mother, they are married for the first time to each other. And guess what? That's acceptable to God because they've conducted them, that is their actions in getting married, have been according to the law of God's law of marriage that God has laid down. Once they're married, then it's because God joined them together. No man can change that. No man can separate them. You can go to 40 different divorce courts. And if there's been no fornication on the part of either spouse, they can be divorced a million times. But in God's perspective, from God's perspective, they're still husband and wife. So someone who has never been married is a candidate for marriage. Now, this is God's law of marriage. It's that simple. But look at what people are doing. They're violating his will so much in the area of marriage. that they get themselves into all sorts of contortions. And if you ever sit down to teach them about pure, ancient, New Testament Christianity, the real thing, they've gotten themselves so warped and so involved in sin, they could be saved, but more than likely they won't. You know why? It takes too much for them to change. And they're not willing to give it up. Well, whose fault is that? Is that God? It's man that's run so far away from God. He's got himself in such a big mess, he's unwilling to do what's necessary to be saved. Jesus gives then, as I've already referred to it, one exception to his rule. And by the way, he who made the rule has a right to set down the exceptions. Jesus made the rule. And Jesus gives the one exception found in Matthew 19:9. He says, "And I say unto you, whosoever," that's broad as the human race, "shall put away his wife," here's a clause of exception, "except it be for fornication, and shall marry another, committeth adultery. And whoso marrieth her which is put away doth commit adultery." Do you see the law coming out here, since the definition of law is a rule of action? So if my action is contrary to the rule, where does that put me? If I tell you as a preacher of the gospel, so-called, that you do not have to assemble on the first day of the week and worship in that assembly as the New Testament teaches, and so you don't, well, you haven't worshiped God as he intended, and you've transgressed God's law of worship on the first day of the week. When a couple divorces and either party remarries again, they commit adultery. And they're not acceptable to God. Now, when I say marry again, that's using it accommodatively. It's simply engaging in what the world calls marriage. So that's been a problem with some people understanding this. But when you look at John the Baptizer, the forerunner of the Christ, when he stood and said, "Herod, it is unlawful for you to have her," that is, the man he called Herod's wife. And the reason he said it, because she's your brother Philip's wife. And yet he says, "Herod married her." Well, we know it can't be a God-joined marriage. But it's accommodative. But it's an unlawful marriage. You see that? It is not lawful for you to have her. Now, it's called marriage. You're living as a married couple. But it's not according to the law of God. Not according to the law of God on marriage. So it can't be a God-joined marriage. God's not going to join a man and woman to be husband and wife when they're acting contrary to his law governing the matter. So when this couple divorces and either party remarries again, then they're committing what's called adultery. And that's not acceptable to God. The only exception, let me underscore the word only, the only exception to this rule is in the case where one of the partners in the marriage commits fornication. Now, I said earlier this morning that I really don't think the New King James Version translates this as it is in the Greek when it says sexual immorality, because there's all sorts of sexual immorality that's not fornication. And it's that sexual immorality that is fornication that is the only grounds for the person, the party, the spouse, who's innocent of such, to have the authority from God to put away the spouse that's committed the fornication. That's it. The only other way is for one or the other of them to die. Now, when what I've described occurs, the partner who is innocent of fornication, who has committed this sin, acted contrary to the law of God on marriage, is permitted by God to divorce the guilty party and start another marriage, because God's dissolved that marriage. So here we have candidate number two. The person who has divorced his or her spouse because the spouse committed fornication, adultery, that person is a candidate for marriage. But the one that's been put away guilty of the fornication, you cannot find any authority in the New Testament that says that person can ever contract another God joined Matthew 19:6 marriage. It's not there. They still hold the blight against them. Now you say, well, you mean they can't be forgiven? Well, they can be forgiven. But since when does forgiveness automatically mean you became a candidate for something? Yes, you can be forgiven. But that person who is guilty of the fornication and has by the innocent spouse been put away, God dissolved that marriage. And that guilt remains with that person from the standpoint of you're the one that did it. Now, while the person repents, says, I know I'm wrong, well, you can live the rest of your life single and go to heaven. You see, it comes down to this, how much do you want to go to heaven? I don't know how many times over my life, I just don't remember, that people have come and gotten themselves to something like this. And my first remark is, before we ever study what God's Word is, are you willing to make the necessary sacrifices if you see you need to in order to go to heaven? Are you willing, even when there's doubt, to choose a way where there won't be any doubt? And truth of the matter is, most people won't. If you act out of faith, since faith comes by hearing the Word of God, you don't act out of doubt. And if you have a doubt about the matter, then you can't act on that and expect God to say everything's all right. That's why that we act out of faith, because that means we know what we're doing. Because faith comes by hearing the Word of God. And when I say I can do this by faith, it means the Word of God permitted me, authorized me, told me that I could do it. That's what that means. The person who has divorced his or her spouse because the spouse committed fornication, adultery, is a candidate for marriage. Now, may I back up a little bit and say, just because the spouse commits fornication doesn't automatically mean at that very moment the innocent spouse says, well, I've had it with you. No, they can work things out. If the spouse who's innocent can find it in his or her heart to forgive the other one and they're willing to start over, that's great. And two people that actually love one enough to become husband and wife according to God's holy state of matrimony, if one did make a mistake like that, then there ought to be something to want to work it out. They ought to do all they can to hold it together, because if they carry it through, somebody never will have authority from God to marry again. And if they want to be married, they ought to do all they can to keep that marriage together. So just because the Bible teaches that an innocent spouse, one innocent of fornication, can put away the spouse that's guilty, doesn't mean he has to if things can be put together. Things can be reconciled. Repentance can take place before there's ever been the divorce. And that's the way it ought to be. All of the straightening out of things, working out things, forgiving of one another, it reestablishing trust, and that's the big part of it. That ought to be done before there's ever a putting away. Because once that putting away takes place, that guilty spouse is not authorized to contract a Matthew 19:6 marriage, God joined marriage ever again. Well, that's just too strict. You know, some people say that about baptism. Well, what about worship? You mean you people in the church observe the Lord's Supper on every first day of the week in the assembly of the saints, and you say it's a sin if you don't? Yes. It's an obligation in the worship assembly of the saints on the first day of the week. It's an obligation to God that we observe the Lord's Supper. Well, that's just too strict. Do you know you take any command of God and there's somebody somewhere that, guess what? They're going to say that's just too strict. Who am I to challenge God Almighty? Remember, God expects us to comply with whatever the rule of action is in any area of our life. Certainly, when it comes to the smallest organized entity of society, the basis of a society. You know why we're having all this trouble in the United States? You mean you can reduce it down to one thing? Pretty much so. It's because of the collapse of the home. People don't like living by the law of God pertaining to marriage and divorce and remarriage. It's exactly what it is. So once you start that, guess what that allows everybody to do in those marriages. But they want to because they're already doing that. They're already doing it. We have one more person who is a lawful candidate for marriage. In Romans 7 and verse 2, Paul writes here to the church at Rome, "For the woman which hath an husband is bound by the law to her husband so long as he liveth. But if the husband be dead," you know, this seems rather plain language to me, "she is loose from the law of her husband." Well, see, there's a rule of action. It's called law of the husband. "So then if while her husband lives, she be married to another," well, she can't be married according to Matthew 19:6, can you? That's accommodative use of marriage. "She be married to another, she shall be called an adulteress. But if her husband be dead, she's free from the law, so that she's no adulteress, though she be married to another man." In other words, the marriage ends when the spouse dies. It's over and done with. So a widow or a widower becomes another class that can marry someone else who's eligible or authorized by God to marry. That seems rather plain. And you know, most of these are plain until we got something that's contrary to those laws that we want more than we want anything else. And most of the time that comes down to some woman wanting a man or a man wanting a woman. That's just exactly what it comes down to. When someone's spouse dies, let me emphasize this, they're a candidate, scriptural candidate, for remarriage. Again, let me emphasize, talk about law. Paul calls this the law of the husband. Now, if you look over to 1 Corinthians chapter 7, and this is, I guess, as good a time as any to do this. Verse 39, scripture reads, again, a letter originally written to another congregation, Corinth. "The wife is bound by the law as long as her husband liveth. But if her husband be dead, she's at liberty to be married to whom she will, only in the Lord." I always thought this was interesting in verse 40. "Under the circumstances which they were living, which involved persecution of Christians, and how that could infringe upon what was obligated for families to be able to do and a husband providing for a wife. But she is happier if she so abide after my judgment. And I think also I have the Spirit of God." In other words, as an apostle, the Spirit of God spoke through me to say these things. Didn't mean he sat down and wrote down his own opinion. In other words, this is something Jesus did not directly address on this earth, and Jesus now is doing so by the Holy Spirit through an apostle of Jesus Christ. So in that situation, Paul's saying, you can go ahead and marry, but under these circumstances, it might be best you abide like I am and just be single. Because sometimes it's hard for a husband to provide for his family when he's shut up in jail because he's a Christian. A little common sense sometimes helps on a whole lot of things. Now, there are some who say there's a fourth candidate for marriage based upon Paul's teaching. In 1 Corinthians 7 and verse 15, and that reads, "But if the unbelieving depart, let him depart. A brother or a sister is not under bondage in such cases, but God hath called us to peace." And so they determined if you have a spouse who's not a Christian and he leaves you because you are a Christian, then the Christian's free to go ahead and contract another marriage. The late James D. Bales, one of my teachers, believed this. It's just not right. If Paul's going to make any comment like this, it's going to be in harmony with Matthew 19, 6 and 9. It's not going to go against it. Some say that not under bondage means not under bondage to God's law of divorce. Well, how do you know that? Not under bondage to God's law of divorce, and that therefore they can remarry again. Well, let me ask you this. Look at the text. Look at the words all the way around that verse. And how do you conclude that? It's just not there. That's just supposition. The text doesn't warrant it. First, it doesn't warrant it by saying Paul would be in clear contradiction, as I said earlier, with the Lord on this point, because the Lord gave only one exception. Surely, if he had wanted to give another exception, then he would have done so somewhere in his earthly teaching. because he certainly didn't in Matthew 19:9. In fact, it helps understand what's involved in the right division of the word. If you read Mark on this, and you go to Mark 10, you won't even find the exception. It's just the general law. Does that not tell us then you have to read all of what the Bible says on a given topic before you can form the view you ought to on the matter? So if you read only the book of Mark and that's all you had, you wouldn't have the same view of marriage, divorce, or remarriage you have when you read all of what the Bible says on it. Because as I've said many times, Jesus, who gave the general law, is the only one who has the right to give the exception, which he did in Matthew 19:9. To what law then is this woman not under bondage? Well, this woman in 1 Corinthians chapter 7 is a Christian who has an obligation to God, God's law of marriage. And by the way, she would have been taught well regarding Matthew 19:6 and 9. She would have understood that. In fact, the question, if you look at it, wouldn't have come up except that she is so determined to hold on to that marriage. What am I supposed to do now? The unbeliever doesn't even want to be my husband or wife anymore. What do I do? Well, it's obvious then that she's looking at what therefore God hath joined together. Let not man put asunder. Well, that's we're in that position. But he's not a Christian, and I am. And now he's leaving me because of the change in my life in being a Christian, let's say. It's her husband who's putting the marriage asunder, but there's no fornication involved. Not a mention of fornication involved in this whole thing. Could fornication into it? Well, of course it could. But if we understood the world at that time, how foreign the Gentiles were when it came to living anything like what Christians lived. I mean, there was just a big difference in the world and those who chose to be Christians. Then we had better understand why it is he didn't want to live with her anyway, simply and only because she was a Christian. Well, she knows exactly what God has taught on marriage. Whatsoever God has joined together, let not man put asunder. What am I supposed to do about him? Well, you're not under bondage to him if he won't live with you. Not that you're not under bondage to what Christ taught in Matthew 19:6, Matthew 19:9. But if he doesn't want to be with you, how are you going to be with him? Is she now going to be condemned by God because her marriage is being broken? Paul is saying that she's not under bondage to pursue, to chase that man, to pursue that marriage in this situation. Now, there's nothing said here about divorce and remarriage. None whatsoever. It's handling a specific question they asked Paul that the Lord, when he was on this earth, never gave as he did Matthew 19:6-9. The situation then only applies to the believer, to the Christian, who is married to an unbeliever. This doesn't apply to unbeliever married to unbeliever or believer married to a believer, a Christian. Many want to use this text as an excuse to end a marriage. But what is the purpose of the text in the first place? To deal with a particular problem they had right there. This woman knows what Matthew 19:6 says. He doesn't care one way or the other. He's not even a Christian. In fact, he doesn't like it because she now changed her life so much in living the Christian life. He just wants to leave her and go back to whatever it was maybe they used to do together when she wasn't a Christian. Whole thing's changed. What he got himself into? Well, what is her obligation in preserving that marriage? You don't have to run after him. Now, later on, he may commit fornication. Well, fine. Then Matthew 19:9 comes to bear. But in this given situation, her obligation is not to have to run after him and chase him all over the place. He's trying to beat her off with the club because he don't want to be with her anymore. So God wants us to keep our marriages whole. That's true. And someone should do all they can to settle the matter. But, you know, if someone just determined not to be with you, it's very hard to be with them. Malachi 2:16 says God hates divorce. I promise you this. Any time there is a divorce, a scriptural divorce, sin's involved. There's never been a divorce that sin was not involved. Might have been on the part of both of them. Might have been part of only one, such as Matthew 19:9. But sin is involved in a divorce. Now, when you are sincere and honest and you know your Bible and you know you have done all you could to be in harmony with the law of God on marriage, divorce, remarriage, but yet your spouse didn't, your spouse was guilty, there's no use having guilty feelings. You know, only guilty people ought to have guilty feelings, but have you ever noticed a lot of guilty people don't? That the people who want to do right and they're concerned about somebody else's soul, who realize the importance of God's law and everything, they're the ones that tend to feel guilty for the other person. So you have to be fair and objective with yourself. Do you know, that's a very hard thing to do, is to be fair and objective with yourself. Sometimes you'll just beat yourself up and you don't deserve it. How do I know I don't deserve it? Because when I consider the totality of the teaching of the Bible on something, and I always come up with, I am obedient to those laws, then folks, you're right. You're not wrong. You have no reason to feel guilty or ashamed. And that's where we all ought to be. We're told, as we've quoted many times, to examine yourself to see whether you be in the faith, unless you be reprobate, that is, disqualified. Well, can you therefore know when you're right? Of course. We've almost got a society that says, you ought to feel ashamed of yourself, buddy, you're right. Have you noticed that? Our society is saying that. That you ought to feel bad because you think you're right and somebody else is wrong. But there is objective right or wrong. And the Bible is an objective document. It's the perfect law of liberty. And it's full of all sorts of component laws governing every aspect of our conduct on earth. Well, am I a Christian? Can you answer that question? Yeah. Study your Bible, the mind of God revealed to us, and you find out what God requires of one to believe and do to be a Christian. And you can answer, yes, I am a Christian, or no, I'm not. I'm glad it's that way. This business of saying, I don't know whether I'm going to hell and I die or not. God didn't intend for us to have that. Read the book, 1 John. And over again, he talks about our assurance regarding salvation. There are some that say that non-Christians may divorce and marry as many times as they wish before they become Christians. But after they become Christians, they may no longer behave in such a way. That'd be all right. Yeah, the Bible taught it. The Bible rejects this idea because God's law applies to all men, whether they are Christians or not. This again, the late Brother Bales taught, that only those in the church are amenable to the law of Christ. Truth of the matter is, you couldn't become a Christian at all if that's the case. Because if I understand it now, and you help me if I've got it wrong, the person outside of Christ is lost, and he must believe the teaching of the Bible regarding what to do to be saved. Well, how does that person outside of Christ and lost ever get into Christ, where God's located all spiritual blessings in heavenly places, one of them being forgiveness of sins? Because he's got to comply with God's law that pertains to becoming a Christian. So if he's not amenable, subject to the authority of Christ set out in his words, what's he going to obey to become a Christian? Though Christ has authority over the whole world, the problem is most of the world never acknowledges authority. But that doesn't mean that he says, I don't have any. That's why he can say, he that rejecteth me and receiveth not my words hath one that judges him. That can't happen except that all men everywhere are amenable to the law of Christ, whether in the church or out of it. You see, to get into the church, all that means is that you have to be qualified to get into the church. And that's the person that hears the gospel, understands it, believes it, repents of sin, confesses faith in Christ, and is baptized into Christ. Now you're qualified to live the Christian life. You're in the church. Lord added you to the church when you did that. Now you're qualified to assemble to worship God, and in that assembly comply with all of the parts of worship. It's a matter of qualification. That's exactly what it is. How do you qualify? You comply with the laws God gives you that allows you to be qualified. So the Bible rejects this idea because God's law applies to all men, whether they're Christians or not. All men will stand before the judgment seat of Christ one day and give an account of the things they've done in the body. Now, when a person dies outside of Christ, how is Christ going to judge him according to his law? That man's not amenable to his law. In fact, there would be no sin because sin is the transgression of the law. Well, it's Christ's authoritative New Testament that's binding today. In other words, how does a person become a sinner if those outside of Christ are not amenable to any law whatsoever? Sin is the transgression of the law. God will judge those who have disregarded his law of marriage and divorce, whether they're Christians or not. We also read in 2 Thessalonians 1:8 that God will render vengeance on those that obey not the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Well, now, is the law of God on marriage, divorce, remarriage a part of the gospel of Jesus Christ? Yeah. Well, what if you haven't complied with God's law of marriage? He's going to judge you. Jesus started preaching the gospel when he began his ministry. Mark 4:23, Mark 1:1, Luke 4:18. Now, we just say that the teaching regarding marriage, divorce, and remarriage, that in that teaching that Jesus gave in Matthew 19:9, are you willing to say it's not a part of the gospel? When you read Matthew 19:1-9, that's not a part of the gospel. That's not a part of the glad tidings of Christ. Well, what is it? Part of the law of Moses? No, you never find anything taught like that law of Moses. It's a part of the gospel of Christ. The inspired writer certainly thought it was, and I frankly just not want to argue with them. I'll just accept it as it is. They were inspired by the Holy Spirit, and they revealed accurately the will of Jesus Christ. And then make it as sure as you can. Do what the Bible said, and the way the Bible said do it, and for the reason, or in some cases more than one reason, that God said it. Whatever the law is. But that also takes in the law of God on marriage, divorce, and remarriage. So the question is, does God accept all marriages? No. Does God accept all baptisms? No. Does God accept all worship? No. Does God accept the Book of Mormon? They claim it to be part of God's Word. Does God accept the Pope and his system? They think that's acceptable to God. The only thing acceptable to God are the laws of God found only in the New Testament, for Christ has all authority in heaven and on earth, and it's manifested in the New Testament of the Christ, Colossians 3:17. So, I hope that helps some. And in this day and age, you go out and try to convert folks to Christ, I promise you, most times when you sit down and study with them, you better get to marriage, divorce, remarriage pretty fast. Because there's so many that have, and they need to come to grips with that to understand what God demands of them if they're going to be saved and go to heaven. If you're not a child of God, we urge you to become one before you leave this building. And as a child of God, if you've sinned, then we urge you to comply with God's second law of pardon, of repenting of your sins, confessing your sins, and praying God for forgiveness. If you need to obey the gospel, we're here to assist you in doing that while we stand and sing.